if you have a Bible and you want to follow along, you can open up to the Gospel according to John, and we're in chapter 17. By way of review, this chapter 17, which is sometimes called the Jesus' high priestly prayer, is really actually the true Lord's Prayer. We mentioned last time that what we call the Lord's Prayer is not really the Lord's Prayer. It's more of a disciple's prayer. We talked about last time that there are 24 prayers of Jesus recorded in the Gospels. All of them are rather short. This one is a whole chapter, 26 verses long of this chapter 17. The timing and the circumstance of this prayer, I think, is very significant. We don't want to forget this because it really sets the tone for what's happening. This was his last night with the disciples before he was betrayed, before he was abandoned, before he was arrested, before he was subjected to an unlawful trial, before he was convicted in a kangaroo court, as they say, followed by his execution, all within a few short hours of this prayer. We don't want to lose the context of the emotion of what is happening at this time. Jesus knew exactly what was coming as he prayed this prayer. The disciples did not. Even though he had been telling them for some time, and he had told them even that he was leaving, not necessarily about the crucifixion, but that he was leaving, he told them earlier in this very night. Jesus knew exactly what was coming as he prayed this prayer. Besides the humiliation, besides the physical suffering that he was about to endure, he was going to experience the full, unbridled wrath of Almighty God. We cannot begin to comprehend what that must have been like. Especially, you're thinking of Jesus, who's God, and we'll talk about this more tonight, coming from eternity past, in the presence of his Father, in all glory, and now he's going to go to a cross where criminals are executed, and not only experience the wrath of Rome, but the wrath of his Father. When we think of this prayer, especially in the context of what he was facing, you know, what would you pray if you were in his shoes? What do we tend to pray when trials are looming? Well, we tend to pray for ourselves. But Jesus did not. He prayed for his Father's glory, and he prayed for his disciples' good. And when I say his disciples, not just those who were there, the 11, remember there's not 12 anymore, the 11, but also for us, because as you'll see, it's going to be some ways away into it, where he says, I pray not only for these, the men who were there, but for those who will believe because of their testimony. And that includes all of us. So bear in mind as we hear this prayer and as we meditate on this, how selfless this prayer is, especially in the context of what Jesus was just about ready to experience. We looked at the first couple of verses last time. Verse 1, Father, the hour has come, glorify your Son, that your Son may also glorify you. So even as he's praying that he would be glorified in his suffering, he wanted that to happen for the glory of his Father. How many times had Jesus' enemies wanted to kill him? But they never could. Why? Because it was never the right timing. And yet here, what does Jesus say in verse 1? The hour has come. It's now time. Now meaning everything that his whole 30 years of life had been leading up to, everything the Old Testament was talking about, and everything that had transpired since eternity past when the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit put this plan in action. The hour has come, but he didn't go into this hour as a victim. We have a tendency to think of him as a victim. He wasn't a victim. He was the Lord, sovereign, omnipotent, and he was in control of everything that happened. That right there is worth meditating on. Remember last time we pointed out that in this hour of humiliation, in this hour of suffering, God's purpose and God's plan was that Jesus would be glorified. The hour is coming when I'm going to be glorified. And most scholars, they don't think this is just talking about the resurrection. This is talking about what's happening in the looming hour of his suffering and of his passion. The hour has come. He would be glorified in that, and in so doing, he would glorify the Father. How counter that is to the way we human beings, even Christians, much less those who don't know the Lord, how contrary to the way we think of what it means to be glorified. We don't even use that word that often, but we think in most cases glory comes as a result of power. If we think of the word glory at all, we think of glory comes in victory, in defeating, in wealth. And in this day and age where we have a group intoxication with celebrities, that's glorious. But no, not Jesus. Jesus is glorified, and in so doing glorifies his Father in the most dramatic. I don't think this is overstretching it, considering where he came from and what he was about to do. He is glorified, and he glorifies the Father in the most dramatic show of weakness, voluntarily, of weakness as he submits himself to this. The greatest demonstration of poverty coming from the riches of glory in heaven. The greatest example of dishonor. What makes it so dishonoring? Many people were crucified. They say some 30,000 people were probably crucified by Rome in those days, in that time frame when that was popular, if you can call it that. But the difference was he's the Son of God. Remember the two criminals that were on either side when they were mocking him, and then one had a change of heart by the Holy Spirit. He says to his fellow criminal, he says, "What are you doing? We deserve what we're getting. This man has done nothing." That's a very important phrase for us to remember, because it means what he experienced was all the worse, all the more dramatic. He was glorified in weakness. He was glorified in poverty. He was glorified in dishonor. And he was glorified in what looked like, in what appeared to be defeat. But indeed it was victory. It was victory for those he came to save. The ultimate deliverance took place. We pointed out in verse 2 that it was in this weakness about which we speak that Jesus was given authority. If you look at verse 2, he talks to the Father and he says, "You have given him, the Son, authority over all flesh," including the people who nailed him to the cross, including the people who ran the trial. He was in complete control of all of this. He was given authority in order that he might save his people out of every tribe, tongue, and nation. What a glorious thing. We concluded last time noting that the people Jesus came to save were, if you notice this, the people the Father had given him. That's an easy phrase to just pass over and think that's nice, but it's something to pause and consider. The people he came to save were people who were known by God the Father from eternity past as those he would save even before we came into existence. We were alive in the mind of God, so to speak. We were his people, the people that he purposed to save, and he gave his people to his Son to save. And it's an amazing thing. The elect are a love gift from the Father to the Son. Then the Son is, and continues to, be saving his people, to be sanctifying his people. What people? The people the Father gave him. And what does the Son do with these people in the end, at the end of time? 1 Corinthians 15:24 says this, "Then comes the end when he," that is the Son, "delivers the kingdom of God to his Father." This means that the Father gives his people to the Son saves them, and then in the end, the Son gives the people back to the Father. The redeemed, and this is a good thing for us to think about, the redeemed are the ultimate love gift from the Father to the Son, and then from the Son back to the Father. What does that point out? This whole thing is a whole lot more about God than it is about us. I mean, we're very fortunate to be the ones who are having our sins forgiven and not going to hell, but going to heaven, obviously. But back of all of that, why was all of this taking place? Because God was so concerned that some people would go to heaven instead of hell? only minimally was that the point. The point was to put his grace on display by giving some people to his son to save, and then upon them being saved, the son gives them back to the father. Hopefully, rather than hearing that and saying, gosh, I thought it was supposed to be about me. Hopefully, rather than having that reaction to what I've just said, you can rejoice that even your salvation, as wonderful as it is for you and as wonderful it is for me, it's about God. It's about his glory. Before we proceed, I just want to say one more thing about the overall of what we don't want to miss when we read John chapter 17. And some of us were talking about this after the study last Thursday night. What a holy privilege it is for us to have this recorded for us. There is nothing like this in the Bible or anywhere else, where we get to eavesdrop, if you will, on the Father and the Son in a holy moment of communion, a holy moment of prayer, where the Father and the Son are so intimately put together, and we get to listen to their conversation. We get to listen to what Jesus says. One of the brothers I liked said, it's like we get this last week, one of the brothers after the study said, it's like we've been invited into the inner sanctum, where it is holy, holy, holy. Be aware of how privileged we are as we give this some more consideration. So we pick up in verse 3 this time, which says, and this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus, whom you have sent. Having just mentioned the eternal life that he was going to give to his people in verse 2, Jesus explains, now again, when he explains, he's talking to the Father, but he doesn't explain this for the Father's benefit. The Father knows. He explains this for our benefit. He explains what eternal life is. In verse 3, he tells us what eternal life is. You know, this is worthy to at least get and remember, if not actually memorize. Because this is what eternal life is all about. Eternal life, according to Jesus, verse 3, is knowing the only true God and Jesus Christ, who the Father sent to save us. You know, if you ask the average Christian, and I'm not talking about people off the street who don't have any thought or care about the Lord. You ask the average evangelical Christian, what is eternal life? I think we might be surprised. We might even be surprised at what some of us might say. What would we say is eternal life? I think it's very interesting. Eternal life is knowing. We'll talk about that in just a minute. Knowing the only true God and his son, Jesus Christ, which means you can't know God, the Father, unless you know the Son. One cannot believe in the Father and reject the Son. People who say, I believe in God, but I don't know if I believe in Jesus. Well, the God you believe in is not the God of the Bible, because the God of the Bible has a Son, and his name is Jesus. So if you don't know him, you don't know the Father either. A couple of verses, also from John, but not the Gospel of John, from the first book of 1 John. 1 John 2:23. Listen to this. I know some of you are familiar with this. John writes this, whoever denies the Son does not have the Father either. Gee, I wonder what he means by that. I think what he means is that you can't have the Father if you don't have the Son. Whoever denies the Son does not have the Father either. And then he gives the flip side of it so we get the full picture. He who acknowledges the Son, has the Father also. What does that tell us? You can't separate the two. He says in 1 John chapter 5, verse 11 and 12, God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has this life. Whoever does not have the Son does not have this life. What life? Eternal life. This, by the way, I won't say specifically because of this verse, but you can link verse 3 with this concept. Why do Christians refer to ourselves as those who know the Lord? Because we do. And that sets us apart, not because we're special, but because of God's grace, of course. But those, the redeemed, those who are born again by the Spirit of God, we know something that the rest of the world simply doesn't know. And we didn't know it either, most of us, at one time. But by the grace of God, now we do. We know the Lord. And when I say we know the Lord, know, not just of the Lord, not just about the Lord, but we actually know Him. You know the difference. I mean, we can read about other people in history and we can know something about them. Whether you want to look at the founding fathers of our country or great people in ancient history or wherever, or even celebrities who are alive today, we can know all about them because we see things and we hear things, but we don't know them. But when you're a Christian, you know the Lord. You know God, and you know Jesus Christ, who the Father has sent. We know Him personally, not just hypothetically, not just from a distance, not just some facts about Him, but we know Him personally, we know Him intimately. It's no accident, by the way, that the Bible speaks of the most intimate relationship between human beings, husbands and wives. The Bible refers to that clear back in Genesis with the word know. And Adam knew his wife, Eve. You don't need me to color a picture. You know what I'm talking about. The most intimate relationship between a man and a woman, husband and a wife, according to Scripture, it's referred to as knowing. We read again of Mary. She says, how can I have a child? For I do not what? I do not know a man. Now, obviously here, there's no sexual connotation in our knowledge of God, but it certainly does, since it's the same concept, the same word, it certainly does hint at the deepest spiritual intimacy that a believer in Jesus Christ can have with the living God. That would be the same word used for a man knowing his wife. And who do we know? The big guy? The man upstairs? Someone up there who likes me? Isn't it amazing the ways that people, and sometimes even Christians, they talk about God. This is God. I remember years ago, before some of you would have been alive, there was a manager, a very famous manager of the Dodgers, who, you know, he's a great manager in baseball, but he referred to God as the Dodger in the sky. And it's like, put your hand on your mouth the next time you're tempted to say that, you know? No. We don't know a higher power that could be the doorknob or anything else that we choose to make our higher power. No, we know, what does Jesus say? The one, and I would say, and only, true God. What does that mean about all other gods? If He's the one and the only true and living God, what does that mean? All other gods are false gods. They're gods of people's imaginations. They're not gods at all. There is only one and there is no other. Now, I want to do something that I did last week with a different set of verses. I'm going to give you 22 different passages of Scripture. You don't need to write them down. You don't need to look them up here if you want to write them down, or if you want, I'll give you a copy of this. I want you to be blown back in your seat for just a second by hearing how many verses tell us the same thing with power. Listen to this. In Exodus chapter 8, verse 1, there is no one like Yahweh your God. In Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 35, God, Yahweh, He is God. There is no other besides Him. Deuteronomy 4:39, Yahweh, He is God in heaven above and on earth below. There is no other. God says of himself in Deuteronomy 32, 39, "See now that I am he, and there is no God besides me." 2 Samuel 7, 22, David says, "You are great, O Lord God, for why? For there is none like you, and there is no God besides you." 2 Samuel chapter 22, verse 32, again, King David says, "For who is God besides Yahweh? And who is a rock besides our God?" 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 60, Solomon says, "Yahweh is God. There is no one else." 1 Chronicles 17, 20, David says, "O Lord, there is none like you, nor is there any God besides you." Isaiah 43, 10, God says, "Before me, there was no God formed, and there will be none after me." Isaiah 44, verse 6, God says, "I am the first and I am the last, and there is no God besides me." Isaiah 44, verse 8, God says, "Is there any God besides me, or is there any other rock? I know of none." I love the way God says that. Isaiah 45, verse 5, God says, "I am Yahweh," or the Lord. "There is no other. Besides me, there is no God." Isaiah 45, verse 14, "Surely God is with you, and there is none else, no other God." Isaiah 45, verse 18, God says, "I am Yahweh, and there is none else." Isaiah 45, 21, God says, "Is it not I, Yahweh? And there is no other God besides me, a righteous God and holy and a Savior. There is none except me." Isaiah 46, verse 9, God says, "I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is no one like me." First Corinthians chapter 8, verse 4, the Apostle Paul says, "There is no God but one." 1 Corinthians 8, 6, Paul still speaking, "Yet for us there is but one God, the Father, from whom all things, whom are all things, and we exist for him, and one Lord, Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we exist through him." Ephesians 4, verse 4 through 6, the Apostle Paul says, "There is one body and one spirit, one hope, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, and one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all." 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 17, the Apostle Paul says, "Now unto the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God." 1 Timothy 2, 5, "For there is one God, and one mediator also between God and men, the man Christ Jesus." And lastly, from the little book of Jude at the very end of the Old Testament, of the New Testament, Jude says, he speaks of the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let me just ask you, how does God's word, how compatible is God's word with the false notion that is so common, even among many Christians, or those who profess to be Christians, that all religions are the same? All religions teach the same thing. Listen, all religions could be false, but they cannot all be true. Why? Because there are fundamental disagreements between them, and none more fundamentally in disagreement with all others than with Christianity. And yet, a recent survey of people who profess to be Christians, not saying they are, because they can't be if they think this, think that 70% in a recent poll in America says evangelical Christians, people who profess to be born again, say you can get to heaven without believing in Jesus. Listen, folks, we may be past the tipping point with numbers like that. All religions are not the same. There is but one God, and all other religions and all other faiths and all other things besides the gospel and Jesus Christ are false. You know, in today's world, that sounds like hate speech. But you know what it is? It's love speech. It's love of the truth, and it's love of God, who predates all things that have come after him. One more thing about the eternality of eternal life that I want to make a comment on. The New Testament word for eternal carries the idea of quality of life as well as quantity of days. The New Testament speaks about eternal life and with the same breath synonymously with abundant life. It's the quality of life. It's life that's worth living. It's life that is, we're finally alive because of faith in Christ. It's more than just a long time, although it is a long time. And that is also important for Christians to understand that we experience eternal life now. We don't have to wait till we die to experience eternal life. When we're born again, eternal life begins for us. He is our God, and He is eternal, and we have eternal life now. We don't have to wait. Eternal life is the believer's present possession. Listen to John chapter 3, verse 36. Whoever believes in the Son has, present tense, eternal life. Present tense is my words added. But let me say it again. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. He doesn't say whoever believes in the life in the Son will have eternal life once you die and go to heaven. Whoever believes in the Son has, present tense, eternal life. Don't wait for heaven to live your life for God. Don't wait for heaven to praise God. Obviously, it's going to be different and way better there. There'll be nothing to get in the way like sin and the flesh and the world and the devil. But in spite of those things, live every day as I'm living my eternal life right now, a life that is of supreme abundance and quality as well as quantity of days. That's, by the way, that's one of the reasons that Christians can face death differently than people who don't know Christ. Now, some people who don't know Christ comfort themselves by saying, well, when I die and I go to the dirt and I'm done. Well, they'll find out that that's not true. But we as Christians, we can not only live well, we not only get to live well, we can die well, even if it's not pleasant. Why? Because I know in whom I have trusted. And my transport, if I can use that name, that word, my transport into the absolute unhindered presence of Almighty God will be instantaneous upon my spirit leaving my body, which is what death is. We're going to go be with the Lord. That's why we can die well, because we know we're just continuing on in eternal life. The eternal life that began the day we were born again and believed in Christ. One more item to note from verse 3, Jesus Christ was sent by the Father. The Father and the Son, as well as the Holy Spirit, are essentially or in their being equal in every way. We understand that, right? We talk about the Trinity every time it comes up because it's an important doctrine. Essentially, the three members of the Trinity, the Father and the Son in particular, who are in light in this passage, are equal. Equal. Economically, which refers not to money, but to function, which is different from essentially, which refers to being. Economically, referring to function, we see that the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit have different roles. But all one God. Trinity, all three are one God, co-eternal. Co-equal. Well, verse 4 continues. Jesus praying to his Father, he says, I have glorified you on the earth. You know, his whole life, from birth, but we'll say from conception by the Holy Spirit, his entire earthly life was lived for one purpose, to glorify his Father, to do his Father's will. See, that's what every one of us were created for. We all fail. That's why we need a Savior who could live that life for us. That's what he did. He lived the life that was all about glorifying God in everything that he did. It must have been annoying to his siblings, you know? Anybody besides me have an older sibling who's perfect? You know, I still think she is, you know? I'm still afraid of my sister. But you know, Can you imagine being a sibling, a younger sibling of Jesus? You know, goody two shoes, man. You're always do the right thing. You never want to go have fun. He lived his entire life to glorify his Father on earth, and he did it for us. He says, I have glorified you here on the earth. I have finished the work which you have given me to do. Now, Jesus was looking forward to being glorified and to glorifying the Father in his passion and in his death and then later in his resurrection. But Jesus glorified the Father throughout his entire earthly life. How did Jesus glorify the Father on earth? Well, how about at his birth? Listen to Luke chapter 2, verse 13 and 14. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. You recognize that. It's part of the Christmas story. Also in the Christmas story, at his birth, Luke chapter 2, verse 20, then the shepherds returned. And what did they do? They returned glorifying and praising God for all the things they had seen, heard and seen, as it was told to them. This is after they went and they found the baby and they said, we saw him. We saw him. And they came away from there just glorifying God. Praise God, even though we haven't seen him. Peter tells us in 1 Peter, him whom we have not seen, we love. And that's why we want to glorify him. How about in his sinless and obedient life? How about those who were said to have glorified God when Jesus healed them? He glorified God and people were healed by him in his kindness and his mercy, and they went away glorifying God sometimes. How about by making disciples? Which, by the way, is what he was referring to when he said, I have finished the work. He glorified God by making disciples. That's what he was referring to when he said, I have finished the work. Some people have said, well, wait a minute. He said it is finished on the cross. Is it finished here in this prayer? Is it finished on the cross? Well, he came with two things, two primary works to do. Jesus was sent to do them, and he did finish them both. We know that one was dying to save his people, which he had not finished yet as he prayed this prayer. But what was he referring to when he says, I finished the work? That's the first work, and that was to make disciples who would continue the ministry after he was gone. He looked at his disciples and he said, it's finished. There they are. You know, kind of a ragtag group, but he poured his life into them, and then later he said, it is finished, while on the cross. The work of redemption, Jesus finished this for his people and for the glory of his Father. The work of making disciples was to get the message of redemption to his people for the glory of his Father, for the glory of his Father. That's why the Bible says every time a sinner repents, the angels in heaven rejoice. Every time, here we are 2,000 years later, every time a lost sinner repents and follows Christ, heaven rejoices. Why? Because they're glorifying Jesus for his work that he came to do that is still happening by saving more. Verse 5, and now, O Father, glorify me together with yourself. And then he says this curious phrase, with the glory which I had with you before the world was. This is one of, I believe, the strongest statements that supports the biblical reality that Jesus is eternal God. He wasn't just a guy who came along and really wanted to do good for God and wanted to demonstrate God's love, so he became a servant, and then he died, and, you know, no. He existed from eternity past with the Father, because the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are all three co-eternal and co-equal. And he says, glorify me together with yourself with the glory which I had with you before the world was, equal in glory with the Father from eternity past. When Jesus became a man, he lost nothing of his deity. This is another very important doctrine. Some people, meaning well, say he laid his deity aside to come to die for us. No, he never set his deity aside. It's impossible. If God stops being God, the whole cosmos. God not only doesn't stop being God, but he can't be stop being God. He lost nothing of his deity, including his glory. God the Son was no less glorious while he was here on this planet, including while he was hanging on that cross, than he was in eternity past with the Father. But his glory while on this planet was veiled. His glory was hidden. This is why people looked at him and said, how can this guy be? He's Joe and Mary's kid. He's the carpenter's boy. How did he learn to say this stuff? How did he, you remember the priests and all in the temple when he was 12, they marveled, how does a 12-year-old boy know all this stuff? His glory was never diminished, even in this life, but it was veiled. I want you to try to think of something that we really can't think of very completely, because we just can't. But try to think of the sacrifice of his incarnation, of his condescension to becoming a man. Think of the sacrifice of living with your glory veiled if you have spent eternity past with your glory revealed, enjoying the praise and worship of the angels. It's hard for me to imagine. He went from the absolute glory of heaven, so absolute, so glorious, I don't think we can begin to comprehend it. We can imagine it, but our imagination is so far short of the reality that we'll be surprised. He went from the absolute glory of heaven to life in a human body. And I bet you everybody over 40 realizes that the human body ain't so glorious after all. I was talking to one of our older members of our church today. I'm not going to mention names because we're on the internet, but I had a wonderful time of fellowship in the Lord. And he was saying, remember when we were young? He's way older than me. He's same age as my father. He says, remember when we were young, we thought we were immortal? Remember when we were young, we thought we were invincible? We know better now, don't we, Errol? I said, yeah, we do. We do. Life in a human body, that in itself is a picture of the glory veiled. How about life in a sinful world? Going from the glory of heaven to living in a sinful world. You and I, if we get on a plane and fly to some third world country where the smells and the sights and the sounds and what have you are not to our liking, we're like, oh, we can't wait to get back home. He went from heaven to this place. Life in a human body, life in a sinful world. In a sinful world filled with sinful people. Some of you may be aware of a book that's been out for several years. I think it's called The Pastor's Wife, is it not? From Mrs. Wormbrand. She said when she was persecuted, she and her husband are the founders of, they're both with the Lord now, but they were the founders of somebody help me, Voice of the Martyrs. And she talked about while she was in Romania during the Cold War years, shortly after World War II, in communist Romania, and she and her husband were imprisoned because of their faith in Christ. And she says in her book, The Pastor's Wife, she says that the beatings, the tortures, the starvation, the freezing cold, all that was, nothing was more troubling than to hear angry, sinful people cursing God and complaining about everything. Now, they had reason to complain. They were in a horrible place. Jesus went from heaven, whereas all he needed to hear, all there was to hear was the praises of the angels and the praises of those who'd already gone on to be with him in heaven, the saints of the Old Testament, and he comes here to a place filled with sinful people. Remember what the Apostle Paul says about us as sinful people? in Titus chapter 3, hateful and hating one another. He comes to this place, leaving heaven in a world contaminated with sin, and that's why there's sickness. That's why there's disease. That's why there's crime. That's why there's wars. It's sin. Sin is responsible for every malady on this planet and every malady that anyone ever experiences. It all, directly or indirectly, goes back to sin. He came to this place and veiled his glory to live here in order to die here, in order to save you and me. And now he's praying, God, Father, restore to me the glory. Let me take this veil off and go back to be with you and enjoy that glory. Now, nearing the end of his mission, he's looking forward to taking off the veil and once again assuming his rightful place that he had from eternity past, his place of full glory with the Father. I believe this is what the writer of the Hebrews was referring to in Hebrews 12:2 when he says this about Jesus, what motivated him, what kept him going, what caused him to go to Jerusalem in the first place on his last trip, what caused him to submit to all of the indignities that he submitted at the hands of those who hated him. It was for the joy that was set before him. For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame. And as a result, what? And he has now sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. The veil off, back to glory. Who for the joy that was set before him. And by the way, what joy is this? And I'll close with this. Not merely the joy of saving us. I can remember thinking that was what, it was the joy of saving us. Well, yeah, but not primarily. What joy motivated him to finish this task of saving his people? It was the joy of glorifying the Father by saving us. It was the joy of glorifying the Father by saving us and then, at last, returning to heaven to be reunited with the Father in that place of full, blindingly brilliant glory. Oh, Lord, thank you that you were willing to veil your glory to save us, and even more importantly, to glorify your Father. And that you are now, of course, seated at his right hand. You are interceding for us. You are continuing your work of your high priestly ministry of interceding for us. But now, from the place of glory. Oh, Father, we long to be in that place with you, reflecting your glory more directly as we have heaven to look forward to. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name.